Yesterday at San Diego Comic-Con, Kevin Feige announced the release dates for the next 5 films in the MCU, as well as a new Blade film and The Star. So today I'm gonna stop and rank all 6 films based on my excitement level from the least to the most. Hi, my name is Sean, and I love to talk about movies way too much. With that in mind, go ahead and join me down below in the comment section. Share your ranking of the 6 films based off your excitement level. Which ones are you super excited for? Which ones do you not even care about at all? Let's have a nice, lively discussion. With that said, to kind of give my general feelings on the panel, I mean, it was just so exciting to hear what's coming next and that it is kind of a big, bold change of direction. Like, if you look at this list of movies, these are risky projects. There's not like an obvious anchor inside of the next 2 years with these movies. So like Phase 2 took some big gigantic risks by doing that movie with the talking tree and the talking raccoon, but you also still had Avengers, Captain America, Iron Man thrown into the mix to make it kind of normal. Here, even when they do a Thor movie, they're doing Lady Thor inside of it. So this just sounds like they are going all out and experimenting. As for me, like, I can't say that I'm as excited for this batch of movies as I have been for some of the previous batch of movies, because I'm just not as familiar with some of these properties, and they are taking such big, gigantic risks. To do kind of a sports analogy here, it's a little bit like they ran up the scoreboard, they know they're gonna win the game, and they're like, all right, let's let the B team in. Let's take a risk on them and see what they can do. They're not running their A team in Phase 4. They're really taking a gamble on a bunch of crazy outside of the box type of franchises. And I think that's awesome. I don't say that as a negative. I just say that as stating the obvious that Shang-Chi is not as popular as Captain America, Spider-Man, Iron Man. So just to state the obvious, that's what it feels like they're doing. So there's a side to it that it wasn't the most exciting set of announcements, but at the same time, I do appreciate that they're gonna try some new and different things. With that said, let's get started. Coming in last place is Thor: Love and Thunder. If you had told me before the panel that the movie I was gonna leave being least interested in was Thor 4, probably would have told you that you were crazy, but that's where we are at. And the simple fact of the matter is, I'm excited about the concept of a fourth Thor movie. They've done some really nice things with him over the last several years. I wasn't crazy about the big Thorbowski, but for the most part, I think they've really developed the character quite a bit. The idea of continuing his story with where they left him at the end of Endgame and his interaction with the Guardians of the Galaxy, all of that seems great to me. Taika Waititi returning, I thought he had a nice voice. The direction that he took the franchise, I think just put a bunch of energy and vibrance into it that I was really excited about. And then they make the actual announcement and it's Lady Thor. And I can't get on board with that. And it's not a problem with Natalie Portman or Jane Foster. I like the idea of Taika Waititi trying to also kind of do his magic with the relationship between the two of them. But specifically the idea of turning Jane Foster into a superhero as Thor, I don't like it at all. And I never was watching the previous movies and like, oh, wouldn't it be awesome if Jane Foster picked up the hammer and just started knocking guys out? That'd be awesome. Whereas you think like Captain America wielding Mjolnir in Endgame, that was awesome because the idea of this hero having Thor's hammer is kind of a cool idea. They teased it for several years. He was worthy and he was facing down Thanos and his army. So in the fate of the universe, so it made sense. But Jane Foster turning her into a superhero, I just do not like it when comic books or comic book movies or comic book TV shows do that kind of thing where everybody gets powers. I just don't like it. If you've seen any of my rankings reviews of the CW Arrowverse, I've repeatedly stated that it drives me crazy that that's what they do with those shows. They turn everyone into a superhero, and I just don't think it works very well. In the words of Syndrome,
and when everyone's super, no one will be.
In fifth place is Black Widow. This one's frustrating for me because I feel like it's a movie that there was a point in time they could have released it or a way they could have done it that would have gotten me really excited. In particular, a few years back, I was thinking that Black Widow and Hawkeye could have made for like a great 10 episode little run of a TV show, like the spy thriller, not trying to be a big blockbuster, but focusing on the spy aspect of their characters, the more grounded side of things. I would have been very excited about that. But when you decide to make a Black Widow movie after her character has already died and setting it, you know, right after Civil War, it just doesn't feel to me like it's so much of a creative decision of the story that they had to tell so much as like they just felt like they needed to make a Black Widow movie at this point in time. Beyond that, I'm not really familiar with any of the director's work. And then looking at the main screenwriter's filmography, you know, the last movie she wrote was The Hustle, the comedy with Rebel Wilson and Anne Hathaway that came out a couple months ago. And then before that, she wrote Olaf's Frozen Adventures. And so I just don't look at the basic premise or the talent behind the camera and have a hook inside of that that immediately goes, man, I can't wait to see this. I'll be there opening day. It's MCU, so I'm excited. But there's not something inside of it that immediately just hooks me. Next up, Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings. Now, I'm a big fan of martial arts movies. Of course, I'm a big fan of comic book characters, but I'm not actually specifically familiar with this comic book character. So I had originally kind of been feeling about this one, I gotta wait until I see a trailer, until I have any sort of opinion formed on this one. Then, as I dove in to start doing my research to do this particular video, I looked at kind of who they had writing the script and who's directing it, and I actually kind of increased my interest just a little bit. The screenwriter David Callum is an actual legit action movie screenwriter that worked on The Expendables. He punched up Ant-Man. He's one of the screenwriters for Godzilla. And as of recently, whoever he's been impressing, like he's working on Zombieland 2, Wonder Woman 2, and Into the Spider-Verse 2, and as well he's working on this film. And so just kind of seeing that body of work, this is someone that a lot of people respect what he's doing. So that kind of made me interested. And then the director is Destin Daniel Cretton, who directed a movie called The Glass Castle a few years back, which is not an action movie at all. It is like a straight up drama in a very divisive film. I have some good friends of mine that absolutely hated it and everything that they were trying to do with it, but it's a movie that really worked for me. I thought it was great and it touched me kind of personally because of the nature of the story that he was telling. And so when I saw he was the worst one directing it from a script from a straight up action movie screenwriter, that was a very interesting little partnering there, making it as well as an MCU martial arts movie, put all those ingredients together. It actually bumped it up. This was gonna be my last on this list, and looking at all those pieces, I went, wow, I'm actually kind of interested in what this movie's gonna turn out to be. So it comes in at number four. Coming in third place is Eternals. Much like Shang-Chi, I know almost nothing about this property, but unlike Shang-Chi, which just kind of feels like a martial arts movie inside of the Marvel Universe, this sounds so bonkers and cosmic that I'm absolutely fascinated in what it's actually going to be. This is the premise for the movie. Set millions of years ago against the backdrop of the war of superiority between the Eternals, superpowered, genetically engineered creations of the Celestials, and their evil counterparts, the Deviants, the film follows the relationship between the Eternals, Circe, and Icarus. Now, I don't really know what any of that means, but the MCU up to this point in time has established this massive universe with cosmic beings that are eternal in nature and teased and hinted at all kinds of things. So the idea that they're gonna make a movie that just dives into the deep end of the wacky, the weird, the cosmic, just kind of gets me excited even kind of talking about the potential of all the things that they could do at this point in time with this property. Throw into the mix Angelina Jolie, Kumail Nanjiani, Salma Hayek. You got a great set of actors, a very different set of actors in here. I mean, we're actually specifically very interested in Kumail Nanjiani, especially after he did Stuber very recently. So I'm interested to see what he will do inside of this universe. And I thought he was the standout in the most recent Men in Black film. So this is one that I don't know what it is, but I'm excited to see what it is. Our runner-up, Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. Now, I felt that the original Doctor Strange was a really good movie with some great visuals, some great casting, but the movie as a whole felt probably the most formulaic, cookie cutter of all of the MCU films for me. Like, they took this really interesting, weird mythology and squished it through their template to make the movie. But ever since that movie, which, like I said, great cast, bunch of things about it I loved, Doctor Strange has just been a scene stealer. When he just shows up in Thor Ragnarok, Infinity War, Endgame, he's just awesome. He's fantastic inside of these movies. Now that he is the fully formed sorcerer inside of these films with all of the arrogance, the confidence, and magic powers. He's a very cool character that I've been wanting to see more of and I can't get enough of. So I'm very excited that they're doing a second film and that they don't have to be limited by trying to do the origin story thing with this movie. They can fully embrace the weird, as it seems like what they're trying to do with Phase 4 is embrace the weird, the wacky, the bold, the risky stuff. And that's what they're doing here. Add into the mix, they said that this is supposed to be the scariest movie inside of the MCU yet. Even the title is a play off of words of In the Mouth of Madness, which I believe is a Lovecraft work, which is terrifying type stuff. And I think that's awesome. I love that they're doing that. I don't know how actually dark they're going to go with an MCU film. It's going to be PG-13. So it'll be scary for my, who will then be 9-year-old son. I don't think it'll be scary for grown-ups or anything like that. But the idea that they want to dig deep into the crazy, the wacky, the weird, that is awesome. Throw into the mix Scarlet Witch coming off of her TV show. They said that the plot line inside of her TV show is going to feed into this movie, which I thought, once again, very cool information. And of course, the title confirms multiverse. I mean, they have talked about multiverse in the first Doctor Strange, inside of Endgame. It's all clearly established that it's out there. But because Spider-Man Far From Home was kind of marketed as a multiverse movie, and then it's not that, it's a Mysterio tricked you movie, there's a little bit of like, oh, I guess they're not doing that. No, no, no. They're going so multiverse, they just put out a title that Doctor Strange is diving into the multiverse pool and taking a swim. So I'm very interested to see what multiverse actually means for them. How does that play out inside of this movie that we're gonna have Scarlet Witch inside of it, that which is gonna be the scariest film that we've had yet? There's a bunch of things, you kind of mix them all together, that just gets me excited to even think about the possibilities. But the most exciting announcement for me was Blade. I am a huge fan of the original Blade trilogy, even the third one, which is not a good movie. It's still a movie that I rewatch all the time. You can actually see my ranking of the Blade movies right up here. Very cool martial arts, horror, comic book movies, and the idea that they're gonna bring them back to the big screen inside of the MCU has me very excited. For years, as soon as they launched the Marvel Netflix series, I wanted them to make Blade into a Marvel Netflix series inside of that kind of pocket universe that they were doing there. And, you know, obviously that didn't happen and can't happen now. And so this announcement at the very end was kind of the thing to me that was like, that was the like, yes, something exciting I didn't know was coming that I'm just pumped about. A lot of the stuff that they announced, we kind of knew it was coming. They gave us the official release date, a little bit of casting, but we were thinking a lot of other things out here, and Blade was the one that we weren't thinking, and I was in no way expecting them to come up and say, Mahershala Ali is going to be playing Blade. I was not thinking that was going to be happening, and so I was kind of closing out. I was live retweeting the whole thing, and was starting to kind of like wind down, getting ready to have family time, and then it was like, Blade's coming. It's like, mind blown, we're getting another Blade movie. Now, Kevin Feige did clarify in an interview with Frosty from Collider that the 2020-2021 release slate that they put the graphic up on the screen, that is Phase 4. Blade is not in Phase 4, he's in Phase 5. That's a different phase altogether. What they announced, that set of movies plus the Disney Plus stuff, that is the slate for Phase 4. So this Blade, it's further down the line and it's a totally different phase from everything else we talked about. But whatever phase it's in, I'm just very excited to see what is this new take, especially because the version of Blade that they did with Wesley Snipes is a very late 90s, early zeros type of action movie. The soundtrack to it, it's also very Wesley Snipes with his personality, his gifting as a martial artist. How do you translate that when you have someone that's not Wesley Snipes? I don't know, but I cannot wait to find out what it looks like. And because it was a big surprise to me, because it's different but similar at the same time, this one for me was easily the biggest announcement, the one that got me the most excited, and the movie, like, I can't wait to see that one and what they're gonna do with the Blade property. So easily for me, it comes in at number one. Remember to tell me your ranking down below in the comments section. Check out my ranking of the Blade movies right over there. Thank you so much for watching, and keep talking movies too much.